What is up, boys and girls? 3X here, giving you a friendly reminder to check out my Twitter page. That's twitter.com/3xgaming, same spelling as the channel. This is going to be where you will get any and all updates as far as upcoming new content, videos, and just random stuff that I like to retweet around the web. Like this one right here. This is kind of a trick question. Even though, you know, mixed emotions. It's kind of a tough choice. But anyway, if you have yourself a Twitter account, make sure to add me to your extensive collection of people that you stalk online on a daily basis. And keep up to date with everything that I'm doing and will do right here, twitter.com/3xgaming. Enjoy the show, everybody. Finally, the XWA is back on the air once again. 3X at ringside here, welcoming you to episode 6 of XWA Takedown. The last one before our next CPV event, XWA Solstice. And there are still some lines to be drawn and business to be taken care of here tonight. And it looks like we're about to start things off with the man who would be the king, so to speak. Man with his sights set on complete control of this company by the name of Tyson Blackheart, the apparent long-lost twin brother of our own president and CEO, Carmella Blackheart. And boy, did things cap off on a volatile note in episode 5 between his soldiers known as Villainy and the Riot Squad. It was a full-scale barroom brawl as we closed out the show. It sounded a lot like the performance of Rottweiler, Adam Warden, and Adrian Aries has more than pleased Tyson Blackheart and has gotten him all the more confident that this war of his is... Oh my, wait a second. Ladies and gentlemen, Victory Musashi has just came out from backstage and I am seriously not liking how this might turn out. Folks, if you were to ask anybody who follows the XWA who is the most dangerous, who is the most ruthless, and who is the most evil man in the company, half of the people that you ask would probably say Tyson Blackheart, and the other half would say Victory Musashi, the leader of World's Finest. And if I'm not mistaken, this is the first time that these two men are standing in the same ring with each other. That is not a good thing. So both of these men making their intentions known to each other here. No reason for them to cross paths at the moment, but the prospect that Victory Musashi is laying out right now is not a very good one for anybody in the XWA. And to no surprise, the CEO, Carmella Blackheart, steps out from backstage, obviously to voice her opinion on this impending situation. And she's definitely smart for doing it. The absolute worst thing that she could have to deal with right now is Villainy and World's Finest working together. But it sounds to me as if she's also got some other plans here. Wow. A tag team main event between Blackheart, Musashi, and the team of Magnus Von Schwartz and Riott. And on top of that, she just all but made another match for XWA Solstice. Riott versus Tyson Blackheart one-on-one. That's an epic encounter if ever I've seen one. The boss just marked her territory here. And I don't think Musashi or Blackheart saw this one coming. Look at the look on their faces. We are just getting started here, though. The opening contest for episode 6 of Takedown comes up next. Welcome back to episode 6 of XWA Takedown, and we kick things off tonight with some tag team action. And making their way down to the ring, of course, Nueva Lucha, representing Victory Musashi's World's Finest faction. To the left, Marco Juventus, and of course, Big Apollo Vega. A couple of young thoroughbreds from south of the border, more than happy in their position in World's Finest as hired guns, for lack of a better term. And speaking of guns, their opponents, a team that has recently formed over in View Japan, these guys you're probably familiar with, Drake Manning and Aki-san, who collectively now call themselves the Shoguns. Nice play on words there. And they've had some significant success teaming with each other over in Japan. Will now try to try their luck here in the States, here in the XWA. Like I said, both of these guys you're probably very, very familiar with in several appearances here on Takedown and exhibition matches. Let me give you a little bit of a rundown of what it is that is going on in the tag team division here in the XWA. Of course, for starters, you have the current tag team champions, members of the faction Katana, Duke Morrow and Itane Tua. Then you have the former tag team champions, Elite Entertainment Enterprises, 3E, Cyrus the Entertainer and Robbie Silk. Then you have the Dooleys, who made their recent return to the XWA and actually defeated the tag team champions with a little help from Cyrus the Entertainer. And then on the outside looking in, so to speak, you've got these two teams right here in Nueva Lucha and the Shoguns, who will certainly be looking to gain some ground or position or momentum or whatever it is that you want to call it in the tag team championship race with a win here tonight. And we're already starting off with some back and forth action. showing off the agility there is Marco Juventus. Certainly considered to be the speed and quickness of his particular tandem. Obviously, Nueva Lucha translates to New Lucha in English. They consider themselves to be the future of Lucha Libre, the next evolution of that well-known style of wrestling down in Mexico. And I gotta be honest with you, these guys are extremely talented without having that bad influence of Victory Musashi corrupting their young minds into believing that they have to be as ruthless and as violent as possible. But you want to talk about ruthless and violent, that dragon suplex right there was pretty much both of that. And a little courtesy bow there by the masked man from Tokyo, Japan, following it up with a Northern Light suplex variation there, no bridge. Juventus counters that, looked like it was going to be a right hand, and a scintillating spinning heel kick, wheel kick, and a drop kick. And showing off to the crowd once again, ever cocky and arrogant is Marco Juventus, who now tags in the big man Apollo Vega. Double arm drag and a combination of kicks to the sternum and between the shoulder blades. And now here comes Apollo Vega with the follow-away slam. These two men certainly have a great deal of history with each other. At one point, Apollo Vega and Aki-san were tag team partners until Vega turned on Aki, nearly put him out of the business. And Aki-san, it took almost an entire year for him to recover. That, of course, culminated in a Lucha de Apuestas match between the two men. At one time, of course, Apollo Vega being a masked luchador, no longer, since he lost that match, and in such, lost his mask. And you gotta believe that is running through his mind like wildfire right now, as he just manhandles Aki-san in his corner of the ring. But Aki with the counter and a swinging neck breaker or DDT, I don't know what you would call that, but it was certainly innovative. Managing to get Vega into his corner and tags in the white hot prospect from Toronto, Canada, Drake Manning, who has certainly shown some flashes of brilliance of his own right here in the XWA, of course, competing in the Only the Strong tournament, still trying to find his stride here in the XWA. And it was a real good move on his part, teaming up with a guy like Aki-san. Not necessarily a good move right there, goading Vega on, knocked him for a loop and followed up with a fisherman suplex. Serious impact on that one. And then following up with a T-bone afterwards. Like I said, both of these teams looking to gain some form of momentum in the tag team rankings. And that would be a shot in the arm for both teams, looking to make a name for themselves. But even more so for Drake Manning, as he's looking to make a name for himself in general here in the XWA. So much talent, so much athleticism in this young man. You have to believe that sooner or later, he is going to be a champion in this business, in this company. Maybe it might be the tag championship. Who knows? All I know right now, though, is a face wash. Foot right across the face of Apollo Vega and a cover. Only getting a two count, but you have to believe right now that Apollo Vega probably still wishes he had his mask. What a clothesline by Manning there. Just turned Apollo Vega inside out. Underestimated power on display by Drake Manning. He is one of the most complete competitors you will find. Technical. He can do high flying. He can brawl. He's got strength. He's got speed. He's got quickness. The only thing he doesn't have, however, is experience. And in a company like the XWA, where you have so many veterans, so many tremendous competitors, having that experience can sometimes be the difference between winning and losing a match. And Apollo Vega now, sidearm lock, pushing Manning back into his corner. And a tag made to Marco Juventus, who flies off of the top rope. Combination plancha powerbomb. Impressive. Team tactics by Nueva Lucha and a cover. Only getting a two count. But man, that was something else right there. I talked about the athleticism of Drake Manning. Marco Juventus certainly has enough of that of his own to get by himself as well. But if it's lack of experience that is the Achilles heel of Drake Manning, it's that cocky arrogance that's the undoing of Marco Juventus. At times where it looks like he should be finishing opponents off, he shows off. And that will come back to bite you more often than not. Marco has Manning's back. And another innovative move right there. Crash Thunder Driver. A signature of Jushin Thunder Liger. Another masked legend out of Japan. Only gets a two count though. Aki-san able to break up the pin and save his team from defeat. And a beautiful snap suplex right there by Manning. Following up with elbow forearm shots right to the traps of Juventus, and a front drop kick of his own. Relentless assault right now by the Canadian. And a tag made here to Aki-san. What are they going to do here? Oh! That was an impressive move as well. Backbreaker and an elbow right into the sternum. And Aki-san following up with some really, really nifty flippity-doo-dahs. That's what he calls it. I'm not making it up, folks. One of the most unique superstars in the XWA, probably in all of core wrestling, but he gets the job done. That's pretty much all that matters right there. And right now, Aki-san is feeling it. He's got something big planned here. The Ultimo Driver. And following up with a frog splash. There was some serious height and velocity on that frog splash following up the Ultimo Driver. Named after the Ultimo Dragon, yet another of the great Japanese wrestlers who Aki-san has idolized. Obviously, formerly trained in wrestling by Yoshitogo, the head of View Japan Pro Wrestling, no doubt. But he is certainly coming to his own as a superstar, not only over in Japan, but here in the United States as well. Certainly one of the most popular guys here in the XWA. And he just got dropped by a front flip plancha. And now a tag made into Apollo Vega, who's a house of fire right now. He just dropped both Aki-san and Manning and Argentine backbreaker across the wide frame like Apollo Vega. That has got to hurt, but not as much as this. The Apollo bomb. Oh my god, that's gotta be it. Unless Manning can somehow manage to, yes he does, break up the pin. But just like that, Nueva Lucha on the follow-up with a double team. Vega showing some height on that kick. Kind of an elevated enziguri. And follows up with a tried and true bread and butter powerbomb. No sit down, no bridge, all impact. Irish whip now by Vega. And a swinging sidewalk slam. Apollo Vega just mauling Aki-san right now. Series of shots. Drops the masked man right down onto the canvas. But just like that, Aki-san counters with a shot to the gut. And another one of those swinging DDTs. And what's he got planned here? Front headlock. And a Northern Light suplex for the bridge. Juventus, though, breaks it up. And Aki-san, dragon suplex with a bridge. Trying to get that quick pin cover. And a combination right there by Manning and Aki-san. Levels Apollo Vega. Aki missing on the frog splash, though. Vega got up just in the nick of time. And Aki-san crashed and burned. That, my friends, is why you call it a high-risk maneuver. Because if it hits, you do damage. But if it doesn't, you get damaged. And right now, Vega's going to try to pour on the damage. But oh my god, poison mist! Aki-san out of nowhere with that poison mist on Apollo Vega, and he goes back up! Hits another frog splash! Aki-san just made it splash! And the Shoguns pick up the win! Wow! That wasn't quick, ladies and gentlemen. That was sudden. If you blinked, you missed what happened. But we got the replay for you, fortunately, just in case you did. Aki-san whipped the frog splash, and Apollo Vega looked like he was going to take full advantage of it. After one Apollo bomb, it looked like he was going to go for a second. And then out of nowhere, poison mist by Aki-san, blinding the man. Another Ultimo driver. And then back up to the top turnbuckle. And if at first you don't succeed, try again. Frog splash, cover, count, victory. And a huge one for the Shoguns, who definitely impressed this crowd. And will be looking to gain more momentum in the tag team division. Welcome back to XWA Takedown. And coming up next, a pure rules match that is sure to be an absolute classic, considering the two men that are about to make their way down to the ring. We start, of course, with the man who is known in Japan as Tetsujin, the Iron Man, Tetsuo Ishida. He is one of the true gladiators over in View Japan Pro Wrestling. a champion of Iron Man matches. We're talking 60 minutes to a finish here. And obviously, as per the agreements, merger, what have you, between these two promotions, View Japan and XWA superstars able to compete freely in both companies. His opponent, however, is a man who is making his return to in-ring action, an XWA alumni. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Chris Cade. And for those of you out there who don't know who this man is, outside of Magnus von Schwartz, Chris Cade is considered to be probably one of the greatest pure wrestlers to have ever set foot in the XWA. His pure championship reign is actually longer than Magnus von Schwartz's was in the vaunted EFED era of the Extraordinary Wrestling Association. This man, basically, if Magnus von Schwartz defined pure wrestling in the XWA, then Chris Cade redefined it. He evolved it into a completely different animal altogether. And now he will be looking to regain what it is that he had in this company. I'm looking forward to seeing what this guy can do. It's been a while. As I said, not only is he returning to the XWA in this match, he's returning to wrestling. This is his first match in a number of years. Semi-retired, but now going back at it full swing. And it's always interesting to see the old guard, all of these alumni, all these old school players stepping back into the XWA ring to see how they fare up against the new competition. And this match is underway. Back and forth with the holds here. Side headlock right now by Ishida. Taking the back end, a snapmare. Nice chain wrestling technique right now by both of these men as they try to feel each other out in the early goings. Front headlock by Cade now. Sidearm lock reversed. Ishida once again from behind in a sidearm lock of his own. Reversed into a side headlock now by Cade. Going front side. And Ishida breaks that up. Wow. And the fans, you can hear the applause. They are appreciating this. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what Pure Rules is all about here in the XWA. And for those of you who are not familiar with XWA Pure Rules, to put it bluntly, there is no ring out. You are not allowed out of the ring at all. And in addition, there are no rope breaks. So no pinfall or submission can be broken by the ropes or the ref. It all comes down to your own intestinal fortitude, because there is no safe area within the confines of the ring in a Pure Rules match. And consistently, Pure Rules Wrestling has been some of the most intense competitive battles we have seen here in the XWA. If you've seen the Only the Strong tournament, you know that firsthand. It's almost a shame right now to think that this caliber of competition is represented at the present moment by a man that goes by the name of Legionarius, who won that pure championship under the most impure of means. sooner or later, he's going to get himself into the ring against one of these guys, a guy like Ishida, who is as intense and hard-hitting as they come, or a guy like Chris Kane, who brings forth an innovative offense the likes that Legionarius has probably not ever seen. And who knows, maybe Magnus von Schwartz can get over the hump. Maybe he can not have to worry about outside interference from World's Finest and reclaim a championship that he realistically never lost in the first place. The Pure Rules division is as robust as they come in the XWA. So many competitors, guys who are basically fine-tuned for this style of wrestling, and even those who think that they are, make for some pretty impressive and intense matches, kind of like the one we're watching right now. Getting back into the action, however, Chris Kane with that shining Kanka kick right to the temple of the Iron Man. And a shot right there. Going to the corner now is Kane. And a backflip in Enziguri. Not bad athleticism for a guy who has not wrestled in over 4 years. Yes, 4 years. It's been a while, like I said earlier. But right now he is feeling it. The momentum is in his favor. The adrenaline is pumping through those veins. This crowd is certainly behind him. But just like that, Tetsujin with the counter. And oh my God, what a stiff knee. Right to the face. There is no nonsense behind the offense of Tetsuo Ishida. He is strong style to a T. The only real technique he has is hitting you as hard as possible and slamming you as hard as possible and stretching you out in ways that the human body is not meant to be stretched. There's just not that much else that I can say, except, well, there goes a barrage of shots right there, an uppercut. Stiff does not begin to describe Tetsuo Ishida. When he hits you, you feel it. Just like Chris Kane is about to feel this. A screwdriver. Right down on the top of the head. There's only one guy in the XWA that uses a screwdriver better. And that happens to be one of the guys who's going to be in the main event. The Masked Marauder himself, Riot. And his infamous 6 feet under pile driver. That's not taking anything away from Tetsujin, though. It certainly has devastating effect, as can be seen right here. Cover. And only getting a two count. But right now, Ishida has got things going in his favor. And oh, wow. That was a stiff head rush right to the back of the head. Like I said, no nonsense. This man uses every limb, every extremity as a weapon. What's he gonna do here now? Oh, clothesline. Kane goes to the opposite corner and a second clothesline and up and down with a sidewalk slam. Tetsujin has got his man reeling right now. And oh my God. Wow. That was the stiffest elbow I have seen. Right to the top of Chris Cade's head, but Cade just countered and drops into a Styles Clash. And I don't know, sometimes you get hit hard enough, you either you fold or you get angry. And I think that's just exactly what happened here with Chris Cade. Oh my. Following up with a moonsault. And something just awoken in the man from Charlotte, North Carolina, rocking the signature Carolina blue right here. And now Chris Cade up to the top turnbuckle. He's going to deliver a superplex of his own, and writhing in pain right there. Ishida, cover, only getting a two count. A wake-up call for Chris Cade after taking that stiff shot and that offensive barrage. Oh! You want to talk about stiff shots? How about a knee to the face? And Cade now. He calls this move the Mass Effect. I call it devastating. Tetsuo Ishida calls it painful, and can it be? Yes! Chris Cade with a big victory here. And certainly a hard-fought back-and-forth match throughout. Both of these men firing on all cylinders. But this was the game-changer right there. That face-breaker setting up the Mass Effect, swinging neck breaker, dropping headlong into the canvas is Tetsujin. And Chris Cade has his arm raised in victory. What a moment it's got to be for him right now in his first match back in action in so long. He's certainly got to be happy with his performance. And I can only imagine what he's got planned for his second run here in the XWA. But hold up, Cade, I think, is asking for a microphone right now. It looks like he's got something to say here. So an open challenge here of sorts from Chris Cade to the pure champion Legionarius. We're going to have to see if he bites on that one. But right now we've got Tara Babcock backstage with a special guest. This is going to be an incredible matchup coming up later tonight. But coming up next, XWA Diamonds on Display. Stay tuned. Welcome back to XWA Takedown. And coming up next, XWA Diamond Division action. Making her way into the arena right now, and also making her debut here in the XWA, a re-debut, so to speak. Vesper Gold. The last time we saw her was on the New Talent Showcase as the right-hand woman of the very interesting competitor known as Magic. What a lot of you don't know, however, is that she also had a brief stint in the XWA herself in the E-Fed era. So, much like Chris Cade earlier on, this is a return to where it is that she was last seen in action. But oh man, does she have a tall order in front of her in her return to in-ring competition. That comes in the form of the Golden Goddess, a golden girl of her own. It's gold versus gold right now, but yeah, this right here is the powerhouse that is Sarah Warfield, a woman whose reputation precedes her. There's really not that much that I need to say about what it is that this lady has accomplished over the course of her illustrious career, not just in the XWA, but in several other promotions. She is, without question, the epitome of what it means to be a strong woman in core wrestling. You think about women out there such as Jamie Fury, such as Arlene Driver, even Tamera. I mean, a lot of them are strong, but Sarah Warfield, she was the first of a long line of these super athletes to make their way into women's wrestling and really reshape things across the board. And so now she stands in the ring with Vesper Gold, both ladies wearing gold and black here. But I think it's pretty easy to see which one of them has the size advantage, which one of them has the power advantage. Warfield just lifting Vesper up like she was a rag doll right there with that flapjack and another collar and elbow tie-up. I don't know if it's a real intelligent move for Vesper Gold to try to match up grappling with Warfield. And yeah, Sarah shows her exactly why right there. But in comes Vesper again. Yeah, you have to give it to her. She's got some intestinal fortitude. I mean, it's not just the raw power of Sarah Warfield that she should be wary of. Warfield is a very technically sound grappler as well. It's not that she relies on her strength. She can also run a clinic. She is an excellent mat wrestler. But right now it looks like Vesper Gold has changed her game plan to good effect, utilizing the speed advantage and the agility advantage that she would have against a larger opponent, the likes of Sarah Warfield. Sidearm lock now into a side arm lock and impressive body slam right there, showing some underestimated upper body strength. It took some effort, but she managed to get the big lady up. But just like that, a step through neck breaker off of a counter Irish whip and another one of those German suplexes, almost effortlessly hoisting Vesper Gold through the air. And a big lariat in the corner. Amateur style Greco-Roman takedown right there by the Golden Goddess, who Irish whips Vesper Gold. Wow, serious impact on that spine buster, kind of like a modified Alabama slam. And another amateur takedown following up with a simple leg drop and the first cover of the match. Two. Vesper gets the shoulder up at two. And right back on the attack is Warfield with a scintillating backbreaker. Fundamentals That's the name of the game for Sarah Warfield. And look at Vesper Gold countering with a German suplex of her own. And putting a whole lot of force into that clothesline. When a clothesline hits that hard, you don't call it a clothesline anymore. It's a lariat. And that was a vertical suplex. Again, showing off her upper body strength. And now, showing off. Just simply showing off. Nice corner splash, however. Look how fast Warfield just popped back up after it. On the follow-up, however, very intelligent by Vesper Gold with that swinging neck breaker. And now, a rocker dropper. Or a famouser, whatever you want to call it. It's face first to the mat. Going for Sarah Warfield and Vesper Gold with the cover now. Only getting a two count. But once again, on that follow-up, just not giving Warfield any chance to recuperate. Vesper Gold, Enziguri shot to the face, and dragging Warfield into the opposite corner, but showing off again, telling her to come on, and that is not a smart thing to do. When you have your opponent reeling, you keep on them. Especially an opponent like Sarah Warfield, who will take advantage of any mistake that you make. And that's exactly what she's doing right now. Oh my gosh, that clothesline. I felt that one all the way over here. And a knee right to the forehead. From behind now is Warfield. And again, another one of those amateur takedowns. I mean, when you have that level of power, why not just use it as much as possible and just slam your opponent into submission? And speaking of submissions, there's this modified hammer lock, collar lock, applied center of the ring, but Vesper Gold managing to escape the hold right there. And look at this, answering back with one of her own, but too close to the ropes. The referee right on top of that one. But Vesper now, Irish whipping a Luthes press and fists of fire. If all else fails, throw with the hands. And, ow, what an innovative idea right there by Vesper Gold. That was like a DDT to the leg. And I think Vesper might be onto something right here. It seems plainly apparent that she is aiming for the legs. And that is a very smart strategy. Because the key for taking down any power wrestler, any larger wrestler, is their legs. On top of debilitating them, on top of slowing their mobility down, you also limit their power. Because any weightlifter will tell you, any Olympic lifter, bodybuilder, anyone who basically trains to gain muscle will tell you that a lot of power, a majority of it, is generated through the legs and a cover. But only getting a two count there. And once again, immediately after Warfield gets herself up after a cover, Vesper Gold hits her with one of those Enziguris. And targeting on the legs again now. Well, not this time. That time she targeted the head. Go low a couple of times and then go up high. Sound strategy in any ring. But Vesper now, Irish whipping Warfield into the corner again. And what's she gonna do here? Going top rope, and I think I know what this is. She calls this the Golden Guillotine. And that one hit the mark. My goodness, Vesper Gold is wrestling an intelligent match right here. And down goes Warfield. That's the same finisher that Magic uses. We could have an upset right here. No. Warfield picking the shoulder up at the count of 2.5. But what a showing by Vesper Gold, just pouring on this offensive barrage. And it looks like she's going to go for it again. I think, yes, dropping Warfield for the second time right on the top of her head. And this could be the match right here. No. My goodness, Warfield kicks out again. This is absolutely amazing. But give it to Vesper Gold. She is not letting up now. I think she might have learned from her earlier mistake. And out clothesline. A second one. Opposite roping. No, she misses on that calf kick right there. And oh my, are you kidding me? Sarah Warfield. The Golden Axe. Out of nowhere. That was just absolutely amazing. And right now, Vesper Gold trying her best to take Warfield down, but nothing doing here. A couple of shots in that big boot. To the ropes. Atomic leg drop. Shades of the immortal Hulk Hogan. And a cover. And Sarah Warfield wins. Vesper Gold showed us something here tonight, that she's not just another pretty face. She's not just Magic's valet, but she is here to compete. And boy, did she show that off. But it was not enough. Sarah Warfield just turned on a whole new level. Countering into the Golden Axe and then just finishing off in classic style. An atomic leg drop for the 1-2-3. And the Golden Goddess just showed this crowd exactly why she is still one of the very best in this business and a true living legend of women's core wrestling. Wow, this was more than I expected, and that's saying something considering you can always expect the top-notch competition in the Diamond Division, but this is just amazing. Impressive victory. And right now, we're taking a look at the tail of the tape of the next match on the card. Christian Phoenix, Jun Suzuki. Pretty much identical in many aspects. Both of these guys, extremely young, extremely talented. But the underlying fact is the fact that Jun Suzuki is the leader of Katana. Are they going to play a factor in this match? We're just going to have to wait and see, because it comes up next. Welcome back to XWA Takedown, and ladies and gentlemen, our next match is going to be one for the ages. This is two men who have been on a roll in their respective careers. And we start out first as the lights dim down and come up with the current New Japan World Heavyweight Champion, Jun Suzuki. As I alluded to before the break, the ringleader of the faction, if you can call them that, known as Katana. And I say that because they're more like a street gang than they are a faction. Since they came to the XWA, they have ran roughshod. Tane Tua and Duke Morrow practically stealing the tag team championship. And of course, the well-documented animosity between the latest member of this group, Kevin Lassiter, and the very man that this man will be facing tonight. These guys have made an immediate impact in a very short stint of time, and Suzuki will be looking to continue on that role in this match against this man. The number one contender for the XWA World Heavyweight Championship. This is Christian Phoenix, a man who, as his shirt suggests, has been on a rise since his coming to the XWA. This guy has it all. He is, according to a lot of people, an anointed golden boy. But don't take that as a negative connotation. He's got all the tools. He's got all the pieces in place to be the man to finally defeat Orion and win the world championship. But of course, first things first, he's got a match here tonight. And he's got a match here against a world champion in his own right, in Jung Suzuki. And you heard what Phoenix said. He's treating this match right here as if it were a title match itself, because that is the level of competition. That is the state of mind, the mind frame that you have to have going into big match situations like he has coming forward at Solstice against the champion Orion. And right now, Phoenix beating down the VIEW Japan champion and letting his opponent know that he is ready for action right now. Countering that shot into a haymaker to take Suzuki down. And now an Irish whip, far corner, and a drop kick that pins Suzuki to the turnbuckle. And speaking of getting pinned down right there, putting the boots to the VIEW Japan champion, is the number one contender for the XWA World Championship. Body slam right there by Phoenix. And just like that, Suzuki managing to counter into a sidearm lock and follows into a neck breaker. And sprinkles on a discus clothesline for added measure. Jung Suzuki, what more can I say about this guy except that he's as ruthless as he is arrogant. He's got a lot of upside to him. Extremely talented, extremely aggressive, and quite frankly, dangerous. There's a reason why he is still the VIEW Japan World Heavyweight Champion, and it's got a lot to do with the mean streak that he has. He is just absolutely vicious once he turns that on, and extremely tough to defeat. And then, of course, there's the fact that he also has a gang of thugs backing him up whenever he actually does get in trouble. That can lead you to some pretty successful title defenses more often than not. But of course, this isn't a title match, non-title contest here on Takedown, but I still don't think that that is going to make any difference to Suzuki or Katana. I'm predicting right now that the second Suzuki is in trouble, somebody's probably going to get involved into this match. And that's got to be something that, quite frankly, Carmella Blackheart has to get on top of. Because right now you have three of these factions running around. Katana, World's Finest, and of course Villainy, that are just pretty much as criminal as you can possibly get. And sooner or later, the president and CEO is going to have to rein these guys in. But of course, that's another story for another day. Getting back into this match, Jun Suzuki has seemed to have gained momentum here and is going for a cover. No score, though, after that knee right to the face of Christian Phoenix. And over the ropes now is Phoenix, and wow! Shoulder checked right out of the ring by the VUE Japan champion. And Suzuki right now just guarding on Christian Phoenix outside of the ring. Stepping back to the center and saying, yeah, I got the smarts. You might have an upside. You might have a blue chip on your shoulder, but I'm the world champion of VUE Japan Pro Wrestling. And now a standoff here. And once again, Suzuki calling out Christian Phoenix. No score on that shot. No score on that shot by Suzuki. And Phoenix answers back with a shot of his own and a springboard guillotine leg drop. Whatever it was that Suzuki said to Phoenix, oh man, he just woke up a sleeping giant, or a sleeping Phoenix, if you will. And a somersault plancha out of the ring, over the top rope and outside of the ring. Phoenix smasher. Christian Phoenix wasting no time, making a statement here. If Suzuki can do it with his words, Christian Phoenix can do it with his actions. And bringing the action back into the ring, Phoenix with the cover. Only getting a two count though. But right now, if you're Jun Suzuki, you gotta be eating your words. When you trash talk like that, you're gonna do one of two things. You're gonna intimidate your opponent to get out of his game, or you're gonna make matters worse for yourself because you're psyching the guy up. And I think, in Suzuki's case, well, okay, maybe not. What do I know? I'm just an announcer here. Whiffed on the guillotine leg drop. Suzuki takes advantage. Goes high risk and it pays off for him. And now Suzuki's slowing the pace down. And that's a smart strategy because Christian Phoenix can turn it on in an instant. And once he's firing, oh boy, he will burn you. But give credit to Suzuki here, keeping things on the mats. Keeping his man at bay, and right now, Suzuki, Rainmaker. That is the stiffest lariat you will ever see. But only as one count, Phoenix kicking out of the Rainmaker. That move right there was part of what gave David Faith a mild concussion at the Only the Strong tournament months ago. And speaking of concussions, DDT from the top turnbuckle. It is quite clear that Jun Suzuki has turned on headhunter mode. And just like that, Phoenix steps through with a neck breaker when it looked like Suzuki was about to get rolling here. And now it's Christian Phoenix who is the man on a roll. Side effect face buster right now, and again to the top turnbuckle, and this time Phoenix pays off with a savage elbow and a twist of fate to follow that up. And we know what comes after this. Phoenix to the top rope again. And the Phoenix splash. Christian Phoenix makes it splash. And he could finish this match off in, no. I knew this was coming. I knew this was going to happen, folks. Kevin Lassiter just jumped over the barricade. And now it's just turned into a 2-on-1 assault. Lassiter and Suzuki putting the screws to Christian Phoenix. and another double team face buster flapjack. I knew of all the guys, it was going to be Kevin Lassiter. These guys were once best friends, but now bitter enemies. And to top it all off, Phoenix is the one who pinned Lassiter in that number one contendership battle royale to get this opportunity at Solstice to face off against Orion. The referee just threw this match out. And I don't think these men care. They do not give a damn. And now it's about to get bad to worse here. Suzuki calling for a steel chair. No, don't do this. Damn it, what? Hold on. Are you kidding me? Orion, the world heavyweight champion, just came in for the save. And now a show of respect by Orion. This has just gotten completely unpredictable here, folks. It is time for the main event of the evening. A tag team match as ordered by the president and CEO of the XWA, Carmella Blackheart. This match made earlier this evening. And standing at the stage, the leader of World's Finest, Victory Musashi. A man whose reputation precedes him as far as his influence, as far as what it is that he has accomplished, as far as what it is that he is looking to achieve here in the XWA. In one simple word, conquest. With his World's Finest faction behind him, he looks to rule the wrestling world. And will go to no lengths to achieve that goal. The same thing can be said about the man who will be, he'll be teaming up with here tonight. Tyson Blackheart, looking for conquest of his own, but not necessarily of the sport, so much as it is of this very company. The apparent long-lost twin brother of Carmella Blackheart herself, emerging from the shadows. He said it himself weeks ago, he is no longer the problem solver, but the problem. And with this group villainy behind him, he's got himself a bit of an army of mercenaries, as it is that Musashi so eloquently stated earlier tonight, that will do his bidding, that will go to war for him. And they've done just that, especially if you saw the last episode of XWA Takedown, coming to blows with the Riot Squad. And speaking of which, how about the match that Blackheart made, Carmella that is, pitting her brother against Riot at XWA Solstice. That's going to be interesting. And now their opponents making their way to the ring. First, of course, Victory Musashi's opponent for Solstice in what's going to be a grueling grudge match, to say the least. The Last Lion, Magnus Von Schwartz. Product of Berlin, Germany. The oldest active roster member here in the XWA. And as I've stated many, many times before, the first ever XWA Pure Champion. I mean, this guy's resume speaks for itself. He is a veteran of this business, this sport, and this industry, the likes that you will probably not see in most other companies. And despite his age, still as tremendous and consummate a competitor and performer as you will see of anybody in this company or any other. He is truly a one-of-a-kind talent. And if you want to talk about one-of-a-kind, there are few, if any, that have reached the level of respect and fear alike as the man that we call the King, Riot. Truly the conscience of the Extraordinary Wrestling Association, where this man walks, people take notice. Of course, well documented, he was literally seconds away from ending the unbeaten streak of the heavyweight champion Orion, if not for the interference of Tyson Blackheart, an issue that he has taken to heart and he will certainly take issue of when these two men square off at XWA Solstice. But you heard what he said backstage before this match begins. He wants to soften Blackheart up. And for that matter, he wants to soften Victory Musashi up as well. Make a statement tonight. Leave these men heading into Solstice as table scraps, ripe for the picking. And now this match begins with Von Schwartz and Musashi trading blows in the center of the ring. Chops, right hands. No love lost between these two men, as much like Blackheart did to Riot with the world title. Victory Musashi costed Magnus Von Schwartz regaining the Pure Championship during the Only the Strong tournament. That belt, of course, now held by fellow World's Finest member, Legionarius. And we still do not yet know what issue Victory Musashi has with Magnus Von Schwartz that has led them down this path of Musashi just constantly being a thorn in Magnus's side. I'm pretty sure at some point we're going to get answers to those questions. But for right now, all we know is that these two men will be competing in a pure rules match at Solstice. That is, despite the fact that it is a pure rules match, going to be a knockdown, drag out brawl between two men who pretty much don't like each other. That is very evident, as you can see here in this match. Just trading blows, showing off on each other, showing each other up. And how about that wheelbarrow suplex and a quick cover by Magnus? Only getting a two count, however. How about Von Schwartz and what he said backstage? It's pretty apparent that he's sick and tired of hearing about how dangerous men like Musashi and Blackheart are. How dangerous groups like Villainy and World's Finest and Katana, for that matter, are. Magnus Von Schwartz is a pretty dangerous man in himself, as is evident by his pedigree, his background, all it is that he has accomplished, the men who he has defeated over the course of his illustrious career. And he'll be looking to add Victory Musashi to that list in Las Vegas. But right now, Musashi seems to have gained the upper hand. Impressive judo throw right there by the ringleader of World's Finest, who tags, who whips into his team's corner and tags in the leader of Villainy, Tyson Blackheart, twin brother of Carmella Blackheart, our CEO. And he's not going to keep this a very pure contest, I'll tell you that much. I've said before about how vicious Jung Suzuki is. You take that and you times it by 10, and you've got Tyson Blackheart. This man, there's a reason why they call him the Red Devil. He is pure evil. And he has no bones about demonstrating this fact to any opponent he has in the ring. Hard hitting, high impact. But Magnus Von Schwartz is pretty hard hitting and high impact himself, and demonstrates the belly to belly, and then immediately follows up with a German suplex. Arguably the best German suplex in the business. And delivering a series of blows right back at Blackheart. Now Von Schwartz to his corner. And tags in Riott. And a scintillating double team there. Clothesline and spear combination. And you have got to believe that Riott has been seething. He has been chomping at the bit for this chance right here to get his hands on one of his own prized pupils from the school of hardcore. I bet if he had any idea the ulterior motive that Tyson Blackheart had even approaching Riott, he probably would have changed his tune. Things probably would have been completely different to where it is that it is right now. But as it stands, difference maker by Riott, who is looking to make that statement he spoke of earlier, but no. Tyson Blackheart with the counter and that big boot He calls that the problem solver, and is that the... No. Riott getting the shoulder up at the count of two. But only gets up to a series of right hands that knocks him right back down to the mat. And once again with those right hands, just beating his opponent down. That's Tyson Blackheart style, folks. And now what's he gonna do? Choke slam. Serious impact, just like I said. And this could be the beginning of the end. This could be the last rites by Tyson Terra, but no. Kick to the gut. And a big boot of his own by Riott. Student showing, or teacher showing the student how it's done right there. And you want to talk about right hands. Pinned in the corner. And firing off with those right hands is Riott. And following up with another big boot, running face wash. The heel of Riott's boot just drilling right into the face of Blackheart. And I'm surprised none of this has busted him open. Ouch. That knee right there to the back of the neck, driving Blackheart face first into the canvas. And a fireman's carry slam, a painkiller light by the man who has mentored the likes of John Payne, Jason Jones, Chad Dynamite, this man in the ring he's in right now, Xander Xavier Luther. He's got a long pedigree of superstars in several different promotions who have been extremely successful. And of course, he also has that pedigree of being one of the most vicious competitors himself in recent memory. And now in the ring with Victory Musashi. These two men have faced each other only once, if you can possibly believe. That was in View Japan Pro Wrestling about 4 years ago. Riott was the one who got the better end of that encounter, and you have to believe that somewhere in the back of his head, that's got to be on the mind of Victory Musashi. And I think, yeah. Oh my God. Going big on the wings of Victory from the top turnbuckle. And if Magnus von Schwartz didn't break up that pin, that could have been the match right there. And now the team of Musashi and Blackheart seems to have taken control, leaving their opponents dazed and confused. Musashi now front headlock. Irish whip. And look at Magnus suplexing Blackheart back into the ring and back to the action in the ring. Looked like Riott might have misfired on that double axe handle. I think he was aiming for Blackheart. Instead, he should have aimed for Musashi, and Victory takes advantage of that situation. Front headlock again now, and reversed by Riott into a modified backbreaker. And boy, did Musashi feel that. Was not able to take advantage of the miscue, the misfire by Riott, and gets knocked clean out of the ring by those soup bones for his troubles. And here's Riott goading his man on and going after Blackheart on the opposite end of the ring. Yeah, Riott definitely wants to take a piece, a huge chunk out of Tyson Blackheart. But distracted once again, going after Blackheart, Musashi taking advantage. And oh, a shot to the lower extremities. And now Musashi signaling for another wings of Vic. No, he's got him hoisted up and drops Riott center of the ring with the World Eater. going for the cover. This could be it. No. Riott kicking out at 2.5. And a series of blows right there. Chops and spinning back fists by Musashi. Follows up with a classic pile driver. And Victory Musashi has taken control of this match. And if there's anybody who can do it, it's this man. We have three at least of the best veterans, seasoned veterans in this company, in this ring right now. But Riott managing to regain momentum, tags Magnus von Schwartz back into this match. Forearm shot right there to Tyson Blackheart. And what's he gonna do here? How about a headbutt? And another one of those beautiful suplexes, belly to belly, with some serious hang time. And it looks like he's gonna signal, hoist him up, and drop Victory Musashi with the broken will. But he's not done. He's gonna go for another one here. No. Takes the back German suplex. A second one. And a trifecta. The triple German. And that's gotta be the end. Well, it should be the end, but I don't think Magnus von Schwartz is done. Another belly-to-belly suplex. Magnus could have pinned Musashi minutes ago, but he's looking, just like he said, to make a statement. He wants to punish Victory Musashi. He wants to soften him up. He wants to make this man hurt. But Musashi one step ahead on that leg drop. One to the well too many. And in comes Blackheart. He's not the legal man, but ask him if he cares. Shot right there. And taking the back of Von Schwartz for this double T move. Double DDT. Driving Magnus head first into the mat and a cover. Only getting a two count. Miraculously, Magnus manages to get his shoulder up. And once again, aiming for the head. Series of elbows right to the temple. That's gotta knock you for a loop right there. And another elbow drop by Musashi. Magnus von Schwartz is reeling right now. He is in a bad way, and he needs to make a tag as soon as possible. Counter from the corner, German suplex by the German. And a clothesline, short arm. Second clothesline just folds Victory Musashi over. And Musashi manages to tag Blackheart in. Shot right there. And a forearm to knock Riott off the apron. And Tyson Blackheart with another choke slam. And what's he gonna do here? He's probably got the last rites in mind again. And it looks like this time it's about to pay off. Up and down goes Magnus. Crashing like a ton of bricks into the center of the ring. And Blackheart with the cover. Riott breaking up the count at two. And this action spilling all over the place. But look at Riott staying into the ring. He grabbed Blackheart from behind. Gave Magnus enough time to regain his composure and regain momentum for his team. That's some good teamwork right there, folks. Tag Team Wrestling 101 by two guys who are not known for being tag team specialists. fallaway slam there from the second rope, and Von Schwartz tags in Riott. And this right here is not the situation that you would want to be in if you are Tyson Blackheart. But you make your bed and that's where you have to sleep. And now, Blackheart gets Bret the Riott Act. And that's not all, folks. Oh my goodness. Clothesline by Magnus. Just taking turns on Blackheart, and up goes Blackheart and down. Buried 6 feet under. Cover. Count. And the team of Magnus and Riott win. If that isn't a statement to be made, folks, then I don't know what is. As we take a look at some of the highlights from this tag team encounter, all four men didn't pull out any stops. Just big moves all throughout. But right here is where the tides change. A little bit of tandem tactics that leads to Riott burying Tyson Blackheart 6 feet under. And you gotta believe that at this point, the momentum is in the favor of the two men with their arms raised in victory as they head into battle at the next XWA CPV. And that's where we're going to leave this one off, folks. Thanks for watching episode 6 of XWA Takedown. On behalf of everybody here at the XWA, this is 3X signing off. We will see you in Las Vegas for XWA Solstice.